I think I'll just get it started, probably. Let's see. OK. So I think its volume is there. That works. OK. OK, so hi, everyone. Good afternoon. And I'm Nayna Jain. I work for IBM Linux Technology Center out of IBM US. And I'm leading the effort for secure boot on OpenPOWER systems. So today we are going to take a deep dive into OpenPOWER host OS secure boot. Okay, so let me just take you through the disclaimer. This work represents the view of the author and does not necessarily represent the view of IBM. All design points disclosed herein are subject to finalization and upstream acceptance. The features described may not ultimately exist or take the described form in a project. IBM is a registered trademark of International Business Machine Corporations in the United States and or other countries. Linux is a registered trademark of Linus Torvalds. Other company product and service names may be trademarks or service marks of others. OK, agenda. So we'll start with a background and a high-level view. Then we'll get into the details. We'll give some thoughts on debugging recovery. And finally, we will end with summary and patch status. I would like to give the acknowledgments to my whole team, IBM LTC security team, IBM security research group, and IBM Enterprise Power Security team, with whom we collaborate. OK, let's start with the basic. So what exactly is secure boot in a simple sentence? And it implies that only authenticated firmware and operating system are allowed to be executed. And why is it so? So this is a rationale. It is industry best practices to prevent and detect malicious firmware. But it is not just a recommendation. It also comes from the evidence of firmware attacks, like bug reports, research analysis, and others you might have already heard in the news. It is a custom and business partner request. And it is also a requirement as part of US government standards. NIST SP800-147B and protection profile for operating system greater than or equal to 4.1 version. US government standards also require trusted computing, which is part of NIST SP800-155, and NSA advisory memo confidence in cyberspace. Our focus is mainly on the secure boot, though the OpenPOWER does has its trusted boot part. OK, to get into the high level, this is how an OpenPOWER boot stack looks like. It starts with SBE. It starts with SBE. SBE loads host boot, ski boot, which loads ski boot and opal, and then comes the bootloader. The key point here, as part of the overall secure boot, is that every layer should verify the next layer before executing it. That is the key point as part of the secure boot. We have this, so SBE verifies host boot verifies ski boot, and goes into the chain. The whole secure boot, in case of the OpenPOWER, is broken down into two domains. One is firmware secure boot. That is the point where ski boot actually loads the boot kernel, which is a ski root. And then the OS secure boot, which is actually loading the final OS, host OS. These domains have their own way of handling the secure boot. And today, our focus is mainly on the OS secure boot side. The ski root, another second thing to remember during the whole presentation is that the ski root is basically, our bootloader is basically the petit boot, which is based on the Linux boot, Linux-based kernel. Linux kernel, that is the ski root. So the next thing is, what does actually a secure boot involves? And there, it can be broken into two main things. One is signature verification. And another is key management. So these are the two important components of the secure boot. And this key management, the keys are required to do or to verify the signatures. So we'll start with the key management, and we will see that how those keys are used to do the verification of the signatures. So let's start here. Yes. OK. What is the key management? So any questions anyone has on to the boot stack side or anything, some basics, if somebody wants to ask before I continue here? And otherwise, I think people are familiar with the boot stack at least. So, OK, what is key management? So the key management is basically managing keys in a crypto system that involves creation, protection, storage, and control over the usage of the keys. So it implies that actually, the keys actually go through the states of key generation and installation, key storage, key usage, and then the key destruction. Now, this is how the high level look of the key management in the OpenPOWER looks like. There are three layers. One is user space, who is actually involved in doing the management. And there's a kernel layer, which is the host OS and the bootloader, which provides the interface for the user space to talk to the firmware. And the firmware is the one which is actually doing the management of the keys. If we go into the more details, this is how the components are broken down. The generation installation and the interface from the kernel side, which you, the interface from the kernel sides, which are involved in the whole this process, are keyring, sysfs, device in IMA. The sysfs provides the user space interface for the management operations. The keyboard, which is the firmware layer and does actual management of the keys in terms of providing the authorization, access to the keys, and access to the keys which are stored into the hardware, is what all taken care by the keyboard firmware layer. This is the persistent storage which is used. We use the combination of TPM and PNOR. PNOR provides the space, but not the security which is needed to protect the keys. And TPM provide that secure storage, but does not provide the enough space. So we combine the good parts of both of them and provide the secure storage for the keys. So we use PNOR and TPM in combination. We will now get into the details of this component step by step. Key generation solution. So what we'll do is we'll follow a top-down approach. We'll start from like what a user will do when he is to start using a secure boot on the system, from where he does the management of the keys, and then how then his keys are used to do the signature verification. So generation and installation. As part of the generation and installation, the components which are involved are the tools, user space, user uses, or sysadmin, the sysfs interface, and the Opal API interface from this key boot. So user space interface and open source key tools. So if I as a user has to start doing this, I need to generate the keys, which should be asymmetric public-private key pair, RSA 204 and SHA-256. I need to store these keys, hold these keys into a container, which is a EFI signature list ESA. This is derived, we are using the container concept from the same which is used by the Tianoco reference implementation. And that is the ESL. This is how it looks like. A single ESL can hold multiple certificates or the keys or the hashes. This the signature format, the command to be submitted, is then uses an authentication header, descriptor 2, which is again taken or derived from the Tianoco reference implementation for holding the signed updates. The minimum utilities from EFI tools, which is used in the case of x86, from the EFI tools, those are ported to PowerPC as secure tools. The key hierarchy being used is EFI-like, which is PK, KEK, DBO, DBX. We are using the similar variables. The current first release supports the replace mode. I'll explain this in the next slide. And then this is the sysfs interface, which is used sys firmware secure wares. And the properties of the key management can be looked at the proc device the IBM Opal. The OS secure enforcing property and explains that the secure boot is enabled. This is how the whole structure, a command submitted by the user or created after using the tools will look like. It has an authentication header descriptor to a signature on the command, which is a PKCS7 detect signature, and the new ESL, which will hold the certificates. Now I have to submit this to the user, to the firmware, but the point is, am I authorized to do it? So if there is a flexible key authorities, because there are three different use cases which can be considered. What is as a sysadmin of this system, if I want to install my own kernel, then I generate, here the thing is the PK is the highest system security authority. And it can be not only for secure boot, but for probably any other security feature also. The PK authenticates to install KEK keys, which is an intermediate authorities, and that allows to install the DB keys. DB keys are the ones which are finally used to verify the kernel. So now, as an admin, if I want to install my own signed kernel, means I need my own DB keys, so I generate my public-private key pair, and I create the ESL, which I sign with my KEK. So the KEK here is a sysadmin. The second use case is what if I'm trying to install a distro package, which I have signed distro package, which I have got like from Red Hat or from Ubuntu, and then I want to install it. So I get a key from them, which I make a DB ESL out of it, but as a sysadmin, I sign it and then submit it. So the KEK is of sysadmin. And this is the thought case. As a vendor, if I want to give you a prepackaged system installed with all the keys, PK, KEK, and DB, then they all are like, I have my own setup there. And sysadmin, it doesn't do anything. The thing is, another key point is that the replace mode means because each ESL can contain multiple certificates, but then you replace the full ESL. You do not append to it. This is what is done in our first release. And the KEK, this one, one KEK can sign the full ESL. It doesn't sign a single certificate. This is the key aspect of keeping it, providing the flexible authorities as per the need. So now, if I wanted to install my DB, KEK, I would have signed my DB using my KEK, and then I would have submitted that command. Where does that command go? It goes via SysFS interface to the firmware. And how that firmware comes is by kernel and the ski boot interface, which is Opel API interface, since we currently support. So this interface actually is a pluggable option. It provides, the kernel provides the secware operations, and any PPC platform supporting, who wants to provide the support for the secure variables can implement this. It provides get, next set. It is enabled as part of PPC Secure Boot, and we are working on the upstreaming of these patches. The Opel part of this is taken care by Eric Richter from my team. Now, the command has gone to the ski boot. It has reached to the firmware, but now it has to be stored. So this is a key update command which I have submitted. And here it is, so there comes into picture the interface for the storage and TSS. The work is being taken care of by Eric Richter, Claudio Cowan, Mauro Rodriguez from our team. So the storage, as I said, we have two persistent storage, PNOR and TPM. We use, the PNOR is partitioned into key store, where we actually store the keys, and then the second is update queue, where we store the key signed updates. The command which we submitted just now for getting a new key installed. So that is where it will get stored, into the update queue. The key store is maintained as two banks so that if we need to roll back for any failure reasons, we can do that. The keys are made available at runtime using in-memory cache in ski boot. There is a pluggable hooks into again onto the ski boot side. So currently we support PNOR with TPM, but what if you want to change your storage device to something else, or as an OpenPOWER vendor, somebody else wants to add something else. So it is a pluggable hook, which can be extended to support different storage devices. And the TPM support is added by using IBM CSS ski boot TSS driver, and it has been modified from using OpenSSL to embed TLS. So now my command assigned update has been stored into the persistent storage, the update queue part of the PNOR. How does it get processed? So do a code reboot. And now the system boots. It's a boot process. And during the booting process, when the system comes back to the ski boot, this is what happens, the key updates processing. And these are the functions which now come into the play. So we'll talk about these components in more details now. OK, so the backend, again, this is taken care of by Eric Richter from our team. So backend actually is a component into the ski boot which defines how the keys and the certificates should be structured, what is the container format, what is the signature algorithm supported. Currently, we support PKCS7, detached PKCS7 signed data format. What secure boot modes are supported, how should they be handled, and what is the key hierarchy. So these all properties are being defined by the backend. Again, this is pluggable, and if you want to change one or another thing, it can be done via adding another hooks into that. The properties of the backend, what version is getting supported, based on which that you can see what properties are being supported via the device tree. Currently, the processing of it is again inspired or derived from the Theano core, and that is where we are using that authentication header descriptor to the way we process. It contains PKCS7, detached signature. That is all, it is derived from the Theano core reference implementation. And the changes to the backend can be viewed by looking at the compatible property. So once the backend is up, is initialized, it starts the key updates processing. So what does it do? The one key thing is, when I said that the PK is the one which decides the highest security authority, it actually defines the secure boot state. If there is a PK, means secure boot is enabled. If there is no PK, means secure boot is disabled. And if secure boot is disabled, it is like a setup mode when there is no verification in that. So assuming now we have the PK, we are verifying the other keys. So if PK is there, how does the processing of the commands goes like? The backend takes the commands from the update queue. It checks the type of the key, whether it is a PK, KEK, or DB, and accordingly verifies it. So PK is verifiable via existing PK, KEK is verifiable via PK, and DB or DBX is verifiable via PK or KEK. You extract the signature from PKCS7, and then you verify for the new SSL. The crypto library which is being used in Ski Boot is MBTLS, and it doesn't have PKCS7 parser support, which we are adding, and we also plan to contribute it to the MBTLS again, but it's a limited support. So this is how the key updates processing is done. Now, assuming the key has been verified and it's being stored into the key ISO, the thing is now, how do you protect it? So the KEK, as I said, the Pino is partitioned into key store and update queue. So the KEK, DB, DBX are stored in Pino, but the PK, which is the highest security authority, that is stored in TPM NV storage because it is secured by itself. How the KEK, DB, or DBX are secured is by adding their hashes into the TPM NV indices. This reduces the attack surface on the Pino side. Then the steps to maintain the Pino secure are this. So as soon as all the processing is done, you update the PK in TPM, we write hashes of the key stored in TPM, and then we write the key stored in Pino. This is like taken from in-memory to the persistent storage. And then we write lock the NV indices in TPM using platform auth. So this step is important because we want to ensure that TPM is not accessible after all the processing is done. So even before any user access is there, like from the petit boot or network file systems or network access is enabled or user mode, anything, this gets done, all of it before then. And once it is done, it cannot be unlocked until you reboot the system. So that is where that is how we protect. So this is how we combine the good properties, the security properties of TPM with the space properties of PNOR and try to provide the full storage, a full secure storage. Okay, and this is how the pluggable storage and backend looks like in Ski Boot. If we need to extend another storage device, these are the functions which needs to be implemented onto as a driver into the Ski Boot. And if we want to extend the backend processing, these are the functions which needs to be implemented. The backend processing functions can be changed, like based on if you want to move from, rather than using PKCS7, if you want to use a different signature format, or if we don't want to use the ESL containers but a different containers. So it depends on like how do you want to define your backend, and accordingly can implement the process, the functionality, can update the compatible flag, and that can get reflected what backend is in use. So this is how it is made extensible. So okay, I have my keys being processed. I have my keys in the in-memory, and I have my keys now stored into the persistent Pino. What is the next? So where are these keys going to be used? And that is where comes the part of key usage. And here comes the key usage part. So we have already seen one usage, which I'll again repeat in the next slide. Another key usage is onto the bootloader side. So why are we doing all this? We are doing all this because we want that when the bootloader loads the host OS as part of the secure boot enablement, it can verify the host OS image. That is the whole purpose. And to do that verification, it needs the keys. And to get these keys, we had been doing all the management of the keys. And our bootloader is kernel-based, so we have used the properties from the kernel or the subsystems from the kernel to do that verification. So let's see. So this we have already seen. This is one usage of keys where we use PK to verify intermediate keys, that is KEK, and we use PK or KEK to verify DB or DBX, which is used, that is the intermediate authority can verify the actual keys which are used for kernel verification. So variable bank is used to verify the update bank. This was one usage of the keys. And this is another usage where we get into signature verification of the actual host OS or the kernel. So let's see. What do we need to consider when we actually want to boot? So as the users of the OpenPOWER, there might be people who they might want to boot with the secure boot, but they might want to also keep trying the booting of the legacy kernels, which are unsigned. So there are different scenarios now. The kernel should be verified if the secure boot is enabled, but it also depends in which state of the secure boot is. And we want to maintain secure boot policies across the kexec, because it is not just the bootloader loading the Linux host OS using kexec, but even the host OS can continue keep doing the kexec. And then we want to ensure that the kexec is load is disabled, which is insecure, when the secure boot is enabled. So these are the some things which we need to give importance to. Now, what is another thing to consider? The petit boot. It can fetch the kernel from different places. It can fetch as a net boot, it can fetch from the NAS, it can from the SAN or the USB disk or local storage. The point is, when you want to do the secure boot, you want to boot a signed kernel. That means a kernel should have a signature. How do you provide that signature with the kernel? There is a support of extended attributes, but the systems like NAS, the network boot, and other things like this, they do not provide the extended attributes. So in such cases, what do we do? So these are some of the things which had been taken care of with our implementation. So let's break it into three things now. Verification requires three things. As a bootloader, I need to verify the kernel, so I need a verifier. I need something which can hold the keys. I have the keys hold into the ski boot, but that is not accessible to the kernel as it is. The kernel has its own in-memory keyring, and the keys has to be available there. And the third thing is, what policy should I use when I'm verifying the kernel? How do I decide? What should I do? So what can we use? Linux kernel provides IMA. IMA is a it is a security subsystem. It also has a key ring, and it also, the IMA provides the IMA policies. And we can use this to achieve our host to a secure boot. How? So let's give two slides for the integrity measurement architecture. IMA is a well-tested and well-proven kernel security hook. It does the measurement and appraisal of files based on defined IMA policies. The measurement implies that you take the hash of the file when you are running it, loading it, or reading it, or writing it, and you extend it to the TPM so that you can later check it via attestation to see if it has been modified accidentally or intentionally. So measurement helps you to detect the changes or the modification in the files done at runtime. The appraisal helps you to verify the signature on the files while executing it, before executing it, against a good known value. So that can be either a hash or a signature. So that is where appraisal helps. And IMA also supports the audit, that is helps into the add to the what was the result of appraisal or of measurement to the audit log system, which can be used in security analytics. The IMA subsystem is maintainers is Mimi Zoha. She's from IBM Security Research Group, and the repo is this, and the mailing list is Linux Integrity mailing list. And this is how the IMA looks like. You can define the policies, measure, appraise, audit. You can define what type of files you want to get verified based on the func during file check or the kernel image check. You can define the mask for it, what type of signature it is, whether extended attribute or something else, and for whether you want to do it for the root user, all the files, or for some other users. So you can define the policies. It is it makes it flexible, like to cover what exactly do you want to measure or appraise. And the steps, which are the sequence in which is done, is measurement first is done, which adds it to the IMA measurement list, which is available at sys kernel security IMA part. After the measurement, you do the appraisal, and then after the appraisal, you do the audit. This is the sequence. This is what we need to use now. So we need to do the verification, that means appraisal, for the kernel, and let's see how we do it. What is our policy? Keyring. So these are the keyrings which existed earlier. The built-in secondary trusted keyrings, these are our compile time keyrings, these are signed keyrings, they verify signatures on keys in kernel modules, and the built-in is not user modifiable but secondary trusted keys, but it has to be signed. .IMA, again, it has to be signed by the keys which are there in built-in and secondary keys, and this is user modifiable. And _IMA is user modifiable, but it need not be the signed keys. But there is something missing here. What is missing? The missing is, they do not trust the keys which are loaded from the firmware. They need it to be signed by the ones which are there in built-in. So they do not implicitly trust in the firmware, which we have in our ski boot. and then verifying signatures on kernel image, file load syscall is what we need for, and they should not be user modifiable. So they have a very limited purpose. So to achieve that, there was a dot platform keying which was added by us in the kernel v5.0, and Nayna support for it. It loads the keys during the boot time, and it accepts non-verifiable keys, and it's not modifiable by user space. So the keys which were stored just now as part of our key management, which we have installed into this key boot, those keys get loaded to the kernel keyring, dot platform keyring, and now the kernel has access to that keys for verifying the kernel. The second keyring, which already existed, and we are using it for our purpose, is dot blacklist keyring, and this is to verify against the blacklisted binary. So there might be case where a particular kernel is buggy, and it is validly signed and all, but it has a bug on which you can exploit a security vulnerability. So you don't want that type of kernel to be booted, but it might be validly signed, and you don't want to blacklist all the kernels which are signed with the same keys. So you want to blacklist only a single binary, and that is called the hash of the blacklisted binary, which you can take care of. That is where the dot blacklist is used. So if a binary is blacklisted and is hash is in dot blacklist, the kernel will not allow you to load it. And this is how it looks like while loading the keyring. The DB keys which were there into the SKI boot are loaded to dot platform. DBX is loaded to dot blacklist. This can again be enabled as part of load PPC keys config, and we are trying to get this upstream. This is how it will look like when we load the keys. This is hash of the binary. Now next thing, so I got my keys. Now I need my policies. How do the Nayna knows what it should measure and what it should do with the measurement? Now there were already supported policies, Nayna TCP, Appress TCP, Secure Boot and Build Time, but there were missing things into this. One of the missing things was these two are custom modifiable, these three are custom modifiable. The build time is not custom modifiable, it is compile time based, but it is not preserved across K. It is preserved across K, but the problem was that it is not, it does not take care of the secure boot state at runtime. If you have it built in, even if the secure boot you disable, it will always, since it is at the compile time build, it will not take care of that. So how do you handle something which you need to know at the runtime? And the other three are custom modifiable, which we didn't want the case, because they are like, and they are also like defined via boot parameters. So you can always k-exec and change the boot parameter, which leads to a vulnerability. So they do not satisfy our requirement. We need something which can be defined at runtime, which is not custom modifiable, which has the highest priority, and which is preserved across k-exec, and it takes care of the secure boot state of the system. So we added the arc-specific Nayna policies. This is defined by architecture based on its secure boot state. It cannot be overridden by boot param option or by the custom policies. It has the highest priority. It disables Nayna appress type. And this policy can be enabled by configuring Nayna arc policy. This is how arc rules look like. So you do it does the appraisal, that is verify the kernel during the k-exec, ensure that it is checked against the blacklist, and use the following method of check for the signature either as an extended attribute or as an appended signature, which I'll talk next in our next slide. And we do it for both the kernel and the modules. And measure, actually, after doing this, it actually adds the measurement rules to the measurement list. We need to focus, this is one rule when both the sequent trusted boot are enabled, but these rules get filtered, there are more rules based on if only secure boot is defined or only trusted boot is enabled. We do a hash of we specifically check for sigfos to prevent duplicate verification of the modules, because module sigfos actually ensures that this is a different K config, and it ensures that the module should again always be verified and the signature signed. So if we don't do this check and we have the appress policy also, then both module verification will also work and Nayna verification also, and we don't want to do duplicate verification. Now I'll come about to appended signature. So we have the policies defined, we have this, but how does somebody sign a kernel image? How does that work? We said extended attributes do not work for the network boot. So what is another way? You append the signature to the kernel image. The appended signature concept already existed in kernel for the modules, and that is how they are currently signed. It is basically at the end of the file you have one signature, and whose format looks like this. And there's already a signed file utility, and you use that to sign the modules currently, but the same can be used to sign the kernel now with the appended signature. So what we did, we took the support of the module style and we tried to reuse it for the kernel. So now kernel is also can be signed as an appended signature. What is the benefit? As part of the network boot, which was not possible with extended attribute, now you can do it because you get a signature along with the file. It is attached with the file. So you don't have to worry. Now you can boot a signed kernel from the network also. And it works with other file systems like FatBest. As part of this, a new template is added, IMA modesig. The thing is, this is because you want to also log the signature, which identifies that file, so into the, so that the earlier IMA templates were not doing that, so this is what it is for. The appended signature also you want to add to the measurement list. And this support has been upstreamed in the v5.4 kernel. And this work has been taken care by Tiago Jang Bowman from LTC team. And this is the initial support for blacklisting, which is added. It loads the DBX keys into dot blacklist keying. The initial support, as I said, is limited. It only checks against the hashes of the blacklisted binary. When I say blacklisted binary, it implies hash of the binary without appended signature. It is not binary with signature. It is without appended signature. And it verifies against the hashes. So the kernel IMA first checks if it is blacklisted, then it's anyway rejected. And if it is not blacklisted, then it next goes for the verification appraisal. You enable this option by adding this flag. If this flag is not there, it will not check for the blacklisting. The blacklist, if a file is found blacklisted, it adds an auxiliary measurement record to mark the blacklisted binary measurement. And there's a new template being used, IMA buff template. We are working towards to get this support added as part of v5.5 kernel. This is how the signatures in the measurement list look like. So this is the IMA template we talked about, IMA modesig. This is the PCR. This is a concept of that. So the PCR belongs to the TPM. The TPM is a secure storage which provides a specific facility of PCR extension so that your hashes cannot be tampered. And they are used for the remote attestation later. So this tells where the IMA extends, in which PCR it extends into the TPM hardware, the hash of the template, the type of the template which is being used. This is the whole hash of the file. And this is the file which is being signed. So here we are trying to do the loading of the module, kheaders.co, and here is the signature. But if this file, if this binary would have been found blacklisted, an additional measurement record you would have seen, which tells what binary was blacklisted. So you can see that this B3D4, let me see if I can show. Yes, B3D4 this one matches with B3D4 this one. This tells that this particular binary is being blacklisted. And that is the tag for it, blacklisted hash. That means you should not be, this byte kernel is not allowed to be loaded. And this happens only if it is blacklisted. If the blacklist, if it doesn't, it is not there, this record you will not see. You will only see this record. That is the difference to be noted. You got the verification done. We have verified the kernel. We have added the measurements. The thing is, bootloader is one level, and the host OS is another level. Once you kexec, the kernel memory is replaced with the host OS. So what happens with all the IMA measurements which we have taken at the ISCII root or the bootloader level? And so we need a mechanism that the bootloader, before getting its memory replaced, can also pass all its measurements to the next level. To specify, this measurement list is used by the attestation services, which use it to detect whether the files which are being loaded are verified with the good known values. And that is like attestation. It can be a remote attestation or local attestation between machines or by the external sysadmins, just to ensure that the system is using the files which are expected. So as part of carrying the IMA measurement list across kexec, when the bootloader loads the host OS, it passes all the IMA measurement list to the next kernel. So these are also available to the next kernel when the host OS, which is available now at the runtime, it can be, it's the IMA measurement list from there can be used for the attestation without losing any information at the bootloader level. This is how the overall flow now looks like. You have the secure boot mode enabled. If it is disabled, disabled implies the highest security authority PK do not exist. If it is disabled, there is no policies set and the kernel verification is not done. But if it is enabled, the keys are loaded to the dot platform keyring, and the blacklist keyring, I specifically said here, but yeah, the DBX is loaded to dot blacklist. This policy is being read through. IMA checks first against the dot blacklist, and if it is not found there, it verifies the appended signature. And this is how if the signature is verified, it loads the host source. So this is where what the bootloader does now. Okay, I got my keys installed. I tried booting my signed kernel. I could get it loaded. And now the next step is I probably now want to destroy my key and want to install new keys. So this is the last phase of the key management, probably, where you might want to rotate your keys or destroy your keys, either because they are revoked, they are expired, or you have lost the private key of it for any such reason. So how do you do it? So to delete DB, DBX, or KEK, you have to submit a signed update with empty data. That means ESL is empty. There is no certificate. That implies it will replace the existing one, and all your keys are lost. Delete PK, submit signed update with empty data if you have the existing PK. But if your PK itself is corrupted, or your PK is revoked, or the customer has lost his PK private key, so you cannot sign with the existing one, or you want to change the ownership of the system, in any such case, you have to use the physical presence. What is a physical presence? It implies that a person has to be available on the system. You give an indication via BMC or remote thing that you want to do or delete, clear the key, but then you have to reboot the system actually doing the button, and then the system detects that there was a physical presence, somebody really wants to delete it, and only in that case the highest security authority PK is cleared. Otherwise it will not. So it actually needs a physical presence. You need to be somebody, a really right or good intentional admin is what is supposed to be doing this. And that is the key destruction. If you want to delete the keys, the key rotation is like, for whatever reason, if you want to rotate your keys yearly or annually and all that, then generate new keys, create the signed ESL file, delete the old one, as I said in the previous, how to do that, and then install the new one. So this is how the whole key management with the signature verification helps to achieve the secure boot on OpenPOWER. All the patches, and like we're trying to get them accepted upstream, both the patches are involved at the key boot level, kernel level. Now, as part of the error logs and recovery, where do you see? So the petite boot UI at the bootloader level that provides you the system secure boot state, whether it is enabled or disabled. The error logs in the OPEL error log tells you about if there are any failures. It gives you details on that. Kernel error in syslog. The secure boot status can be verified via device key properties. If OS secure enforcing property is available, it means secure boot is enabled, otherwise it is not. The key update processing status is available via update status, which tells whether the key updates had failed, passed, and the reason for it, like authentication failed, invalid signature, or the invalid metadata, the timestamp failure, any of those. If the PK private is lost, you have to use a physical presence for the recovery. That's the only way. And here is the patch status. The patches are going on for the SKI boot to provide the kernel OPEL interface, backend, storage APIs. There's also the embed TLS limited support for PKCS7 that we are working on. These are the kernel patches. Some of them are already there into the older ones, but these are the ones which are going recently. And these are waiting for the acceptance. And the user space side, we are coming up with the SQL tools, which are the EFI tools, the minimum utilities from EFI tools ported to the power and being used as SQL tools, which will be like, we are working, it's a work in progress. And these are the references. And yeah, any questions or anything? Yeah. P9,
oh no, it's
P9.
Okay, so There's a system. The system has to support it too. It's not just a function of the chip. You have to have a TPM chip on the system.
Yes, you have to have the TPM chip onto that. So. Yeah, and then it's not all P9 hardware. So there's again, this is what we're talking is all secure boot context. So not all P9 hardware, but whatever is like our next release will be, it will be supported. Yeah.
Or will you get your hardware some way packed into the older systems?
Yeah, I mean, then you can do that with OpenPOWER and you can try your own secure boot changes. Yes. Yeah. A virtual environment, you mean the guests under the OpenPOWER system supporting secure boot?
Yes, we can run QEMU and do testing.
Yes, so that is something we are looking into, and there will be something onto that in future. So that is work in progress we are looking into. Anything else? Okay. Looks we are good. So, okay, thank you everybody. And if you have any questions, you can mail me later also. And mailing list is always there anyway. So, okay, thank you.